Welcome to Civil Services Achievers Point. We are discussing the Assam Tribune of 31st August 2020. At Civil Services Achievers Point, we have various courses. To enroll in the courses, you may call at a number given below. You can also follow us on the social media platforms. This Assam Tribune analysis is based on the new pattern of APSC. However, it is also useful for the other state level government examinations. These are the important newspaper articles we are discussing today. Also, the important aerials we will discuss today. The first topic we are discussing today is government explores the possibility of single voters list. Now, this topic we are studying under the General Studies 2 paper. Topic Polity and Governance. The government is discussing the possibility of having a common electoral roll for Lok Sabha, Assembly and local body for Lok Sabha, Assembly elections and local body elections to avoid discrepancies and bring uniformity in the voters list. So this is a possibility which government is discussing. At present, the Election Commission prepares the electoral roll or the voters list for Lok Sabha and Assembly polls. So this point is important. The Election Commission prepares the electoral roll or voters list for Lok Sabha and Assembly polls. The state election commissions, which are altogether separate bodies as per constitution provisions, hold elections for local bodies. So state election commissions prepare the voter list and hold the elections for the local bodies only. And for the Lok Sabha and Assembly elections, the elections are held by the Election Commission. Now the center is exploring the possibility of having a single voter list for Lok Sabha, Assembly and local body polls, as this can help bring in uniformity and also save costs involved in entire exercise getting repeated for making separate voter list. So it will be saving the manpower cost and overall cost because many of the exercise are repeated. There are provisions in the constitution that empower states to formulate their own laws to hold panchayat and municipal polls. States also have the powers to either have their own voter lists or to adopt the one prepared by the Election Commission for Assembly polls. So states can either prepare their own voter lists for panchayat and municipal polls, but they can also take up the list, voter list already prepared by the Election Commission for Assembly polls. So money is spent for the same exercise twice. One rule can be good for voters, and also there will be no discrepancy in local body and assembly voters list. So this point is important. Students, in our reforms for our electoral process, this is a very important step. Now, regarding this proposal, the Election Commission, Law Commission and Parliamentary Standing Committee on Law and Personal Ministries and Personal Ministries have supported the idea of a single voter list in the past also. So this idea has been supported by various bodies and government agencies. Now, coming to our next topic, center writes to states suggesting options of borrowing money. So this is so as to make up for GST shortfall. So this is to make up for a GST shortfall. This topic we are studying under the General Studies 3 Economic Development. The central government wrote to states suggesting options of borrowing money to make up for the 2.3 lakh crore shortfall in GST revenues expected in the ongoing fiscal. So in this fiscal year, there is expected to about 2.3 lakh crore shortfall in GST revenues. the finance ministry wrote to state governments saying that they could either borrow via a special window, it will facilitate through the RBI, or they may raise the debt, or they collect the debt from the market. Now, in a special letter sent from the finance secretary of the union government to all the finance secretaries at the states and the union territories, it said that additional borrowing by the center influences the yields on the central government securities. It is government securities, G-Secs. It is government securities and has other macroeconomic repercussions. So as we know that the government yields, the yield of government securities are benchmarks for various, not only government, but also private entities. So additional borrowing by the center may impact on the yield of the central government securities. So the yield on state securities do not directly influence other yields and do not have the same repercussion. So it is advised that the state should additionally borrow. The center has estimated that out of this 2.3 lakh crore, 97 crore compensation requirement is due to the GST roll, and the remaining is on the account of the impact of the COVID-19. So it is the fall in the GST revenue is two parts. One part is because of the GST rollout, and the other part is of the impact of the COVID-19 on the economy. In the GST Council meeting on August 27, the last month, Finance Minister had said that the COVID-19 is an act of God, and it was necessary to differentiate between GST shortfall and the pandemic-related shortfall. So the 2.3 lakh crore shortfall is divided into two parts. One is the GST shortfall, and the other is the pandemic-related shortfall. Now, giving two options, states can borrow either 97 crore, the deficit arising out of the GST implementation, or the entire 2.3 lakh crore. So the center has given two options. Now, explaining in detail the borrowing options to meet the shortfall, further, the finance secretary has said borrowing by the states typically incurs a higher interest cost than borrowing by the center. So the government of India is conscious of this and has factored this aspect with a view to protecting the states so that they are not adversely affected. So under the first option, what is the first option? If the states choose to borrow 97,000 crore, which is a shortfall under the GST, under a special window, the center will endeavor to keep the cost at or close to the government security yield. So it will keep the cost closer to the government security yield under the first option. Such a borrowing would be over and above any other borrowing ceilings for which a state is eligible. The yield on government securities acts as a benchmark for state borrowing as well as private sector borrowing. Hence, any rise in central borrowing costs ipso facto, that is indirectly or directly, drives up the borrowing costs of all borrowers, including not only states but also the entire private sector. So the yield on government sectors acts as a benchmark for state borrowing as well as private sector borrowing. Hence, any rise in the central borrowing costs drives up borrowing costs for all borrowers. The interest on the borrowing under the special window will be paid from the cess or the tax as and when it arises until the end of the transition period. Further, the letter said, under the second option, now what is the second option? Under the second option, the entire shortfall of 2.3 lakh crore will be borrowed by the states through the issue of market debt. The interest shall be paid by states from the resources, while the principal on the amount under will be paid from proceeds of the cess. Further, Further, as per the design of the options given to the states by the center to meet GST compensation, if the states decide to meet the entire shortfall of 2,35,000 crore, including the COVID impact of, portion, through the issue of market debt, then additional unconditional borrowing limit of 0.5% and the final tranche of 0.5% provided under the Atmanirbhar Bharat package as a COVID relief measure will not be available separately. So this is mentioned in the directive. So under option one, the center has offered a special borrowing window to states in consultation with the RBI for an amount of rupees 97,000 crore, which is the GST fallout, at a reasonable interest rate. The center will endeavor to keep the borrowing cost at or close to the government security yield, and in the event of the cost being higher, will bear the margin between government securities and the average state development loan yields up to 0.5%, that is 50 basis point, through a subsidy. So this is the proposal under the option one by the government. Under the second option given by the center, allows the states to borrow the entire projected GST compensation shortfall of rupees 2,35,000 crore for the financial year 21, but this borrowing will be allowed by subsuming the additional unconditional borrowing limit of 0.5% and the final tranche of 0.5% given to states as a special limit to fight the COVID-19 pandemic. So this is the two options given by the central government to the states. Now, moving to the next topic, the Banks Board Bureau, that is the BBB, recommended the name of Dinesh Kumar Khara, SBI's senior-most managing director, as the next chairman of the country's largest lender. So this is very important from the prelims point of view, that one question may come regarding the Banks Board of Bureau. Then one question may come, who is the chairman? Who is the chairman of SBI? Because these questions are frequently asked in our APSC prelims. Khara will replace SBI's chairman, Rajneesh Kumar, whose three-year term comes to an end on October 7. So now the BBB's, the Bank Board Bureau's recommendation will now be forwarded to the government. The final decision will be taken by the Appointments Committee of the Cabinet, headed by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So as per convention, the SBI chairman is appointed from a pool of serving managing directors at the bank. So moving on to the next topic, the Minister for Information, Electronics and Information Technology launches Startup Contest Chunauti. So this is a prelims-based question may come, or a mains-based question may come, that what are the steps government has taken for promoting self-entrepreneurship and startup. So here we may add this point that the IT minister launches Startup Contest Chunauti, and this topic we are studying under the General Studies 3 paper, Economic Development topic. Now the background is that Minister for Electronics and IT, Ravi Shankar Prasad, launched the Next Generation Startup Contest Chunauti, which aims to encourage startups and software products with special focus on the tier 2 towns, so on the small towns and the small cities, so that software products and startups can be encouraged. The Next Generation Startup Contest Chunauti is launched. And Chunauti is a Hindi word for challenge. So this is another method how the schemes are named. So students, please try to relate, because if in exam, if any term comes as Chunauti and if some options are given, you should remember that Chunauti means challenge, and it's a challenge for creating more and more startups and innovations and providing job opportunities. With an outlay of about 95 crore over a three-year period, the program aims to identify around 300 startups working in identified areas and provide them seed fund of up to rupees 25 lakh and other facilities. So this is the provision under the program. Under the challenge, the Ministry of Electronics and IT will invite startups in areas such as educational technology, agricultural technology, finance technology solutions for masses, supply chain, logistics and transportation management, as well as infrastructure and remote monitoring. So these are some of the areas in which the startups will be encouraged. Startups selected through Chunauti will be offered various support from the government through the Software Technology Parks of India centers across India, STPIs. They will also get incubation facilities, mentorship, security testing facilities, access to venture capitalist funding, industry connect, as well as advisories in legal, human resource, intellectual property rights and patent matters. So a pool of resources will be allocated to them, and also guidance will be given to them on important matters. Now coming to the next topic, NRC publication completes 1 year. Now this topic we will study under the General Studies 2 paper, quality topic. As publication of the National Register of Citizens, NRC, completes 1 year, the central and state governments are yet to clarify their stand on the document. Also, the process of issuing, there was a provision for process of issuing rejection slips to those whose applications for inclusion of their names in the NRC were rejected, has also not started. The 200 proposed foreigners tribunals for hearing petitions of those whose applications were rejected have also not started functioning as yet. Applications of more than 19 lakh persons for inclusion of names in the NRC were rejected as they failed to provide adequate proof of citizenship and their fate hangs in balance. So the various tasks of issuing rejection slips, the various proposed foreigner tribunals for hearing petitions of those whose applications have been rejected have also not started. So the provisions of the NRC are in standstill and many processes have not started because of the COVID-19 pandemic delay. As we know, a brief background has been given here. The NRC was prepared after years of demands and agitations. Immediately after the Assam agitation started, the ASU submitted a memorandum to the Prime Minister on February 2, 1980, demanding that the NRC of 1951 should be updated. The ASU reiterated a demand in 1990 in a memorandum to the central government. In 1999, in an official level talk on the implementation of the Assam Accord, it was decided that the NRC would be updated and the center agreed to pay rupees 20 lakh for the same immediately. A tripartite talk on the implementation of the Assam Accord was held on May 5, 2005 under the chairmanship of the then Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh, where it was decided that the NRC would be prepared within a time frame of 2 years and the state government created a directorate of NRC. But the process did not get off the ground. Again, in 2010, the center decided to start a pilot project in two revenue circles, Soigaon and Bopeta. However, it was suspended after violent protest by a section of people in the Bopeta. Following the incident, a group of ministers was formed to formulate modalities, while the ASU and 29 organizations representing different ethnic groups of the state joined hands to hold talks with the government on the modalities. Again, the process resumed with the appointment of state coordinator for the NRC in 2013, and the process gained momentum after the Supreme Court started monitoring the process. The partial draft of the NRC was published on December 31, 2017, and the final draft was published on July 30, 2018, leaving out the names of 40 lakh people. The final NRC was published on August 31 last year, that is 2019, after hearing the claims and objections. However, as per different organizations, the different organizations expressed their reservation on a number of persons whose names were not included, as they feel that the actual number of foreigners living in Assam should have been more. So this is an update on the latest development of the NRC. Now coming to the most another important topic, the Delimitation Commission. The Delimitation Commission members to visit Northeast soon. This topic we are studying under the General Studies 2 paper topic quality. The Delimitation Commission is all set to redraw the Lok Sabha and Assembly constituencies of Assam, Manipur, Nagaland and Arunachal Pradesh besides Jammu and Kashmir. The commission was set up in March this year. So the commission members will soon visit the northeastern states and the union territory after preparing a broad framework of the delimitation exercise. The panel will seek views of its associate members, a group of Lok Sabha members and MLAs after drawing up the framework. The framework is proposed to develop. The constituencies will be developed based on the 2011 census. So this is an important point. Students, please make a note of it. The commission is headed by former Supreme Court Judge Justice Ranjana Desai, retired. Election Commissioner Sushil Chandra is the representative of the Election Commission in the panel. So this is the update regarding the Delimitation Commission. Now, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi has stresses on India, making India a toy hub. It is vocal for local toys. Now, this topic we are studying under the General Studies 3 Economic Development. Also, this can be also studied under the GS3 culture topic, because toy making and puppetry is a part of our Indian culture topic. So this also has cultural aspects in this topic. Noting that the global toy market is worth over 7 lakh crore, that India's share is very small in the sector, the Prime Minister has given a clarion call to be vocal for local toys, stressing on the need for making the country a hub of toy making or toy. In a monthly radio program, the Mann Ki Baat, Prime Minister of India said India has talent and the ability to become a toy hub. The Prime Minister said that the toy industry is very diverse and some of the regions in India are being developed as toy clusters to make the nation a toy hub. Channapatna in Karnataka's Ramanagara Kondapalli in Andhra Pradesh Krishna, Thanjavur in Tamil Nadu and Dhubri in Assam, and Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh are among the places in India which are being developed as toy sector. So these places are very important. A match the following question may be given in the match the columns or match the following type of questions may be given the prelims based question MCQs. Students, please make a note of these places. Channapatna in Karnataka's Ramanagara, Kondapalli in Andhra Pradesh Krishna, Thanjavur in Tamil Nadu, Dhubri in Assam and Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh. There has been further, the Prime Minister says, there has been a rich tradition of local toys in our country. There are many talented and skilled artisans who possess expertise in making good toys. Now, Modi said that he was thinking about his young friends and how they can get more toys. He said that toys, best toys are those that bring out creativity. So this is a multi-dimensional point which may be used in our mains answers. In the national education policy, the Prime Minister said a lot of attention has been given on the impact of toys on different aspects of children's lives. Learning while playing, learning to make toys, visiting toy factories, all these have been made a part of the curriculum. So educational aspect is also mentioned here. Further, he says that industry linking like cottage industries, small industries and MSMEs Also, big industries and private entrepreneurs should also come in the ambit of this. The entire country will have to work hard together to take the toy industry forward. So, further, the Prime Minister said the country will have to persevere together to promote this. Mentioning the works of C.B. Raju in Visakhapatnam, the Prime Minister said, one, the Etikuppa toys of his village were very popular as these were made of wood. And secondly, there are no any angles or corners in these toys anywhere. So the Prime Minister has given a multi-dimensional point regarding the toy making in India, because it will be a boost for our tourism, for our traditional artisans, craftsmen. It will be a boost to our educational policy. It will be a boost to our MSME, cottage industry, livelihood and employment generation, private investment. So multiple benefits are there if India goes for toy making. Now the next important topic is need to demarcate Dipor Bill's boundary to protect the Jumbo habitat, that is the elephant corridors. Now this topic we are studying under the General Studies on Assam paper, Biodiversity and Environment topic. The Dipor Bill Wildlife Sanctuary, which is an integral part of Dipor Bill, the lone Ramsar site wetland of the state. So a prelims based question may come in exam that what is the only Ramsar site wetland Assam? It is the Dipor Bill. So the background is the Dipor Bill Wildlife Sanctuary needs to have its boundary properly established and its integrated management plan properly formulated or devised. This wildlife sanctuary is inalienably or it is directly linked with the Rani and Garbhanga reserve forest ecosystems too. The Dipor Bill was declared as a Ramsar site in 2004. Students, please mention in the comment section this Ramsar site. This Ramsar is a location of a country. Which country's location is Ramsar? Name the country in the comment section, because a question may come in the prelims MCQ based question. A 4.1 square kilometer area of it was notified by the state government as a wildlife sanctuary in 2009. So Dipor Bill is very important because Dipor Bill is a Ramsar site. Dipor Bill Wildlife Sanctuary is a wildlife sanctuary. So it is a very ecological sensitive system. And the wetland is also a major stormwater storage basin for the city of Guwahati. Many migratory birds visit this wetland during the winter, and wild elephants from Rani and Garbhanga reserve forests also visit this wetland frequently. But the Dipor Bill Wildlife Range existing watchtower, which is used to watch the movement of the wildlife elephants coming down from the Rani and Garbhanga rainforest to wetland, also the picnic spot and the restaurant, has been causing disturbance to the jumbos or the elephants, as the campus watchtower and the restaurant and its picnic spot are near an important elephant corridor. So these developmental activities may impact the movement of the elephant through the elephant corridors. That is why it is proposed the proper demarcation of the boundary of the Dipor Bill and the formulation of an integrated management plan in accordance with the Wetlands Conservation and Management Rules 2017 of the Union Government. So further, it is said that increased human presence on the southern bank of the wetland may lead to stopping of the movement of wild elephants from Rani rainforest to Dipor Bill permanently. So this demarcation and the integrated development plan is required very urgently. Further, it says that the Garbhanga reserve forest elephants come to Dipor Bill via the Rani rainforest, and both the rainforests are habitats to over 100 Asian elephants and thus are an important habitats of the elephants. Besides other wildlife ecologically important for environment too. Also important point is here that after 1986, the Asian elephant has been listed as endangered on the IUCN red list. So this point is important. Students, please make a note of it. Now coming to the important aerials, two very important aerials we're discussing. The first is the illegal wildlife trade. This topic we are studying under the General Studies 3 paper, Biodiversity and Environment. So the aerial discusses that with the onset of the pandemic for India's Northeast states, two major developments have happened. One is that several natural lovers would corroborate the fact that quite a few wild animals could be seen roaming fearlessly in erstwhile crowded areas. So the due to the lockdown, many wild animals were seen roaming in the cities or in the nearby countryside areas since the national lockdown. However, another aspect of the COVID-19 pandemic situation was that illegal transit of wild animals was reported throughout the country. Abdul Alim was trying to smuggle about 250 numbers of star tortoise costing more than 60 lakhs from the Madurai International Airport to Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia in September 2015. Again, Delhi-based ivory racket kingpin Umesh Agarwal along with accomplice was caught by the Wildlife Crime Control Bureau in Kerala in October 2015. In terms of numbers, West Bengal recorded the most cases of wildlife crime in 2018, followed by Maharashtra, according to a report published by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Other states reported high number of cases include Assam, Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Madhya Pradesh. Also, the most of these wildlife are illegally traded because the demand for the organs of these animals, which are believed to have medicinal properties and they have markets in such as China and South Asia. Also, trade involving the live animals or their various body parts are sold in many parts of Gulf, Europe and Northern America, and the transition parts or transition locations include India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Sri Lanka and Myanmar. The global illegal trade in wildlife, it is worth up to $19 billion annually and is the fourth largest illegal market. So it's a huge worldwide market, and unfortunately India is also India is also on the road to the illegal transit route. India is among the top 20 countries for illegal wildlife trade, and Chennai and Mumbai airports act as key destinations and origin points for traffickers, according to a report published. The most common items smuggled as a part of such trades are include the Indian species and products commonly smuggled out of the country are tiger and leopard skins, their bones and body parts, rhino horns, we know, ivory, that is the tusks of that elephant, turtles and tortoises, sea horses, snake venom, mongoose hair, snake skins, gecko and moira lizards, sea cucumber, musk pods, musk pods, beer bile, medicinal plants and many birds. Of late, toke gecko has come into the picture, and in 2007, more than 1,000 geckos have been confiscated from Northeast India. So under the Chapter 5A of the Wildlife Protection Act 1972 mentions in bold terms on the prohibition of trade or commerce in trophies, animal articles, etc. derived from certain animals. Mainly includes animals under Schedule 1 and part of Schedule 2 of the Act. So Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 of the Wildlife Protection Act, this provides for serious or more serious punishment for the wildlife mentioned in the Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 of the Act. And needless to say, the Wildlife Protection Act is silent about exotic animals or plants, even though that falls under the critically endangered or endangered category in the IUCN Red List. So various penalty provisions are vividly described in the section 51 of this chapter, banking on all the stringent provisions of Wildlife Protection Act. Several notable persons in India were brought to book for various crimes in wild animals. In spite of the stringent act, which is in force since 1972 throughout the country, trade on wild animals is going unhindered. An official survey of the Sonepur cattle fair in Bihar, led by the traffic 7 years back, had unveiled shocking details about the illegal animal trade rampant under the guise of the fair. Animals sold here are brought from various parts of India and Nepal. Recently, we have come to know that the animals in the market are transported from Assam, as well as include some species of birds, monkeys, and elephants. Further, it is observed that operation in October 2018 was carried out simultaneously in Chennai, Kolkata, Guwahati, and Aizawl. And in June this year, Kolkata airport officials arrested a man with exotic macaws and parrots native to South America and New Guinea. The birds were smuggled from Bangladesh and headed for Bengaluru. And latest, we had observed that this year, on July 28, forest officials in southern Assam's Kasar district rescued a kangaroo and 6 hyacinth macaws, few capuchin monkeys, and some Aldabra giant tortoise from Mizoram-Assam border. So, such activities show that Assam and the Northeast are in the middle of the illegal trade of wild animals. Now, next topic we are discussing is the Assam Pran Harendranath Borua ideals he fought for. Now, this is a very important topic from our Assam GS paper from both prelims and mains point of view. Harendranath Borua, 1909 to 1987, was concerned with the national issues from the pre-independence era till the later period of his life. Now, some of the important contributions of Harendranath Borua are mentioned here, that it was decided that Assam will be part of the erstwhile East Pakistan or East Pakistan, but under his leadership, Assam became the part of Indian Union only. So the British used the divide and rule. So the British merged the Gwalpara district of Assam, the undivided Gwalpara district of Assam, under the administrative unit of the Rongpur, which is now in Bangladesh, and that facilitated the influx of the East Bengal migrants to Assam. And the British, since the British annexation of Assam, the British alienated the Assamese from all forms of economic activities. They introduced opium to destroy their industriousness, all forms of economic production and military zeal, which was mastered during the Ahom rule. Also, Assam was done to develop a British market for their industrial products. Also, laborers were brought from Madhya Pradesh and Orissa for the expanding the tea plantations, and local tea growers were suppressed and punished for trivial issues. In 1938, Gopinath Bortoloi became the premier in Assam, but had to resign in 1938 at the request of Mahatma Gandhi for the outbreak of World War II. And then the leader of the Muslim League, Syed Sadullah, was the premier of Assam from 1939 to 1946. Now, Sadullah supported the British and reformed the land revenue system, introduced the line system, and encouraged East Bengal Muslim immigrants for the Grow More Food campaign in Assam to generate more revenue for the Assam. As a member of the executive committee of the All India Muslim League, Sadullah took part in the Lahore session where the Pakistan resolution took shape in 1940. Later, Sadullah stood for the inclusion of Assam in the Pakistan. So if the way of Sadullah happened, then Assam would have been now part of Pakistan. A great visionary, Horendranath Barua confronted these crucial issues of apprehension of Assam and merging of with Pakistan. He challenged this scheme of the British, and with this combination, he waged a war against the British designs through his writings to generate public opinion and guide the Congress Committee to protect Assam from being merged with Pakistan. And he wrote many articles and books like Assam's Position, A Short History of Assam, People of Assam, Race, Religion and Language, Reflections on Assam come Pakistan, Assam Claim for Jalpaiguri and Darjeeling, Problem and Corridor. As we know, this Darjeeling and Jalpaiguri area and Kuch Bihar area should have been in Assam, but due to the dirty politics of British and Bengal, it went to the now West Bengal. So, in the process, he helped Nobin Chandra Bordoloi and others in the Assam Congress Committee to explain the apprehension of the Assamese before Mahatma Gandhi and Chakravarti Raja Gopalachari. In 1947, India and Pakistan emerged as two independent countries. However, Assam lost the Jalpaiguri and Kuch Bihar, but retained the personality as Assam. So, this achievement was brought to the platform by Assam Pran, Horendranath Barua. But this doesn't mean that the relevance and efforts of Barua and other Congress leaders have ended with the passage of time. These still persist as the guidelines for the present and future generation of Assam. So students, this is an important way how essays should be written. So an essay in APSC, if on Assam part comes, this is how conclusion should be made. So with this, today's current affairs discussion, we are ending now. I hope this session was helpful. Thank you for watching. Thank you.